Gospel of our Savior.
Praise to you, Jesus.
Please be seated. Fire and water, they both can cleanse and they both can kill. They both can harm and they both can heal. They both can rise and they both can fall. We are drawn to fire and water at times, and there are times when they drive us away, like wildfires, like hurricanes. We speak of baptism by fire and baptism by water. God's power is often spoke of as fire and water. We say that God is a mighty refiner's fire. We say that God is the living waters, like the woman at the well in the Gospel of John, chapter 4. And then there is that famous passage from Amos, chapter 5, verse 24, quoted famously by Martin Luther King, Jr. Justice will roll down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. When we want to speak of somebody doing something really powerful, we say they're on fire. There's a very popular song now that goes, "This girl is on fire." And it is an anthem for women everywhere about their empowerment. We talk about somebody having a belly full of fire. Or when an athlete does an amazing thing, we say, "He's on fire." And what we mean is somebody who is so filled with the Spirit and with the manifestation of their gifts, whether they are an athlete or a ballet dancer or a poet, that when all of those gifts are flowing through them, we say, "Wow, that person was on fire." Well, today we hear about a reading of all the disciples set on fire by the Holy Spirit on the Feast of Pentecost. Because God comes as the Spirit, as divided tongues of flame above their heads in such a wild way to make everybody take notice. God is here, and it's not in a little flickering candle on the end of your altar. It's fire above people's heads, and you better watch out. And to make it even more obvious how God works, God suddenly makes these disciples speak in every language of the people, the Parthians. They're coming from all different places to this gathering place in Jerusalem. And God says, "I'm going to make an obvious miracle happen. Fires above their head and language flowing through them that they didn't know they could speak." That's Pentecost. And what happens? When Peter is set on fire, the first thing he does is he says, "Oh, we're not drunk." His belly's on fire with the Spirit, and he starts to preach his first sermon. And in his first sermon, he says, you let them kill Jesus, and you killed the wrong guy, because he has risen, and now we are going to rise up as the people of God. And people are so stunned by what he says that they get baptized. We talk about baptism on Pentecost, not just on Easter Vigil, because we talk about getting baptized by fire just as much as getting baptized by water. We're used to thinking of baptism as this gentle droplet of water on a baby's head. But what it was really meant to do was to dunk somebody in a river so as to drown them, kill them in their former life, and have them rise up with Jesus resurrected by the power of the sacrament of baptism. And then we say there's a baptism by fire to mean something very different, that somehow you got thrown into something faster than you thought you would. You're going to have to react in a way you didn't think you would have to. You're going to have to do things you didn't think you were going to have to do, because somehow the Holy Spirit sets you on fire. We have fires burning in our land right now, quite literally. We have fires burning in cities. in Minneapolis, in Atlanta, in New York. And they're burning because of people's great sense of mourning, lament, anger at the injustice perpetuated upon people of color in our country. And as much as I would like to preach to you today about how Jesus brings peace to us and makes us give each other handshakes and kisses of peace, the fact is, Jesus also comes as a mighty rushing stream and as a fire that sweeps through the land and says, you will be overtaken unless you get with the program and you get with God's sense of justice. What these protesters are saying is that no justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. We as Christians often speak of Jesus as the Prince of Peace, and that our faith, our communal love for one another and our neighbor will somehow bring about peace. But actually, peace is the effect of justice. It is not the precursor to justice. It only comes when God's justice is happening. And when injustice happens at the hands of people who are meant to be officers of justice, lawyers of justice, judges of justice, it causes outrage throughout the land. As I was sitting here last night working on this sermon and thinking, oh gosh, you know, in a time of shelter in place, would I really talk about this? Don't my people need a word of comfort? I listened through my open dining room window at the walkway right out here, and I'm looking at the 3 14-year-olds sitting on the stoop outside the rectory, and they were talking in a very agitated way about the happenings in our land, about the protests over the murder of George Floyd, a police officer kneeling on his neck for minutes after minute, even as he begged to be able to breathe. For what? Suspected, not convicted, but suspected of passing a fake $20 bill. And I heard these teenagers agonizing about it. 2 white, 1 African-American, 2 boys, 1 girl. And they were having those hard discussions that teenagers have when they're trying to figure out how to have talks about things that they haven't really talked about much before. And one was saying, the only reason it's on TV is because the officer was white and the man was black. And the other was saying, well, that's because white officers don't kill white people. And the other was saying, no, it just doesn't make the news when white officers kill white people. And I listened to them, hurting for the pain they were feeling about what's going on in their land. Clearly a group of friends trying to figure out how to talk about race, when how those 3 children encounter the world is very different. 1 a white male, 1 a white girl, 1 a black male. Just children trying to make sense of the pain in our country. We know that this pain is a result of our country's origins through slavery. That slaves were brought to this country first by the Spanish and then by the English settlers in order to have free labor. And the way to make people be enslaved is to subjugate them, to take away their land, to take away all they had, whether they were Native American or Africans imported here, and to let them believe that another race was superior. And our country still struggles with this white supremacy. We still struggle with white privilege to the detriment of every person of color in this country, whether black, brown, Asian, Pacific Islander. I didn't interrupt those children. I had to go outside actually to pick up something that had been delivered. And as I walked out past them, they turned and looked at me to see if I was going to tell them something. And I thought, no, I'm not going to tell you anything because I don't know anything more than you do. And what you are the sacred ground group. That's what I thought. These are like our sacred ground groups, looking at something happening in the world and trying to figure out how to respond as a white person, as a man, a boy, a girl, as a black boy, knowing that how all of us encounter the world is very different depending on our cultural situation. We heard today that we have been given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. That all of the gifts given to us, gifts of our spirit, gifts of our body, gifts of our intellect, are given to us for the common good. Not for me to be better than you, to be richer than you, to be more powerful than you, but for me to care for you as much as I care for me. I saw many signs of hope these past few days as I watched the news. And you might find that hard to believe because obviously it's caused me some pain as well. But here's what I saw in hope because I looked for it. I looked at who was protesting and I saw a multiracial, multicultural crowd. I saw a crowd of children, teenagers, young adults, middle-aged people, and old people of all backgrounds protesting. I saw police unions across the country agreeing that what happened to George Floyd was a travesty and not the way police officers should behave. Surely they also don't want to be held responsible for what a few police officers have done in this country. But at the same time, we have to recognize that our justice system has unfairly targeted Black people. I feel hope because I got an invitation from the San Diego Organizing Project, the clergy group, which is primarily, by the way, African American preachers in San Diego. I got an invitation to talk with them about what we can do. And in our many meetings that I've spent with them over the past 3.5 years, I've learned a great deal about what it's like for them to be a pastor in San Diego and what it's like for me to be a pastor in San Diego. And it's very different. They're working on avoiding cameras in every single public park and on every street corner to try to catch people doing something. They're worried about people being mistreated. They're worried about people being unlawfully detained, given much heavier sentences for minor things such as passing a bad $20 bill. And I have hope that they will give me something to do. I have hope that I, as a white person, will do something to get out of my home and to try to make a change. But I want to tell you something else that gives me a great deal of hope, and it is our sacred ground groups. So many of you are participating in them. So many of you of every background in our church are participating in them. And it gives me hope because you cannot go through a sacred ground discussion for 10 sessions learning about the various peoples of our great nation without recognizing the great pain that has occurred in this country and that we are being prepared to do something about it. And so what I expect, those of you in session 8, session 9, session 10, what I expect is that you're going to get to the end of the road and you're going to say, what now, Janine? Don't leave us hanging. We got to go do something now. And you are going to lead us in the next stage of making justice in San Diego. I feel great hope about the fact that fewer white people I know are sitting back and saying, well, if the police did that to him or her, then she must have done something wrong. I feel great hope because no longer do we ignore people when they talk about Trayvon Martin or George Floyd or Tamir Rice or Sandra Bland or Breonna Taylor, and I can go on and on and on and on. Now other people know those names, and we're not alone in this work, those of us who care about it. All of these things give me hope. And so the peace that I work for is the peace that comes from justice. It won't be the kind of peace that floats down from the heavens and just alights upon us when we pray. It will be the peace that comes when we know that our brothers and sisters of color are safe. And what I want them to know as they listen today is that we've got your back. And when we don't have your back, call us on it, and we'll be there for you. Amen.